She might say she loved me. She don't love me like she says she loved me. Wrong! Mother Nature loves us. The water cooler outside is coming up next. This outdoor edition of the water cooler. You know the crew by now. It's Grace Marlowe, Chris Lopez, Josh Cohen. Incredible out here. In
great
the
to
elements.
Be out here.
This has been a work in progress, a long time coming. The water cooler takes its talents to the great outdoors.
So Mother Nature, we're out here.
We're doing it big.
Yeah. And this is what the live on-campus show is about.
This is
it's
it.
About we're rolling. We're rolling through it.
We just roll through it. You know,
we're
we tried
excited.
Something new and we're going for it.
So
we're doing it big.
Yeah.
So we start out with USC Pro Day. Just this past Wednesday, saw a lot of guys out there. Some of the guys are going to stand on their numbers from Indy. Juju Smith-Schuster, Adoree Jackson, didn't see him run the 40. They were good in Indy, said our times were good. But other guys, kind of under the radar guys, the Daquans of the world. Daquan Hampton, that is. Isaac Whitney, only 11 receptions in his USC career.
Definitely Isaac Whitney.
Blazing speed. What did you guys see, especially from those under-the-radar guys?
Well, Whitney, first and foremost, you know, a lot of talk about Adoree Jackson at the combine, but Whitney put up a lot of similar numbers in his drills, really comparing himself, even though it's a pro day. As you said, only 11 receptions, not a whole lot of on paper to prove him as a prospect, but in terms of the numbers he can put up as an athlete, sort of making some buzz, maybe get him drafted, you know, in that late third day kind of stuff. Also, Darius Rogers with a 4.9, you know, don't know where he'll end up on draft. If it could be a late steal.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the thing to look at with Darius Rogers' 40 time. Not great. I believe Josh ran a faster 40, as we'll see in the cooler comment.
Josh did
about
that.
A 40.
South Central, but it is someone who a team could look for that late steal because it does drop his draft stock a little bit. But you got to look at what the guys do in the regular season. It's really making the difference for people like Whitney who haven't had that performance. But Darius Rogers, I don't think this really changes my mind about him. Guys have bad days. They have bad moments. You let them roll through it.
Yeah, no, I think that overall, not a whole lot of guys to make a big splash. You know, Steve Tuiaka, I can't say his last name at all, but a defensive tackle, had a big day on the bench reps as well, improved his numbers on the combine. A couple of small steps forward for our guys, but all in all, the guys who made their statement really was at the combine with Adoree and Juju. So we'll see how this affects the draft stock going forward.
Juju
we'll go with Stevie T.
Take off the hat.
Stevie T.
Juju did not take off the hat. That is confidence.
Incredible. Justin Davis, worth noting, ran a 4.49, so not bad from the running back. We'll see where he goes in the draft if he gets picked up somewhere. Great time here. Now, USC football is in action at the moment. Current players, no longer Adoree, no longer Juju. Spring ball, a chance for some of these young guys to make an impact. Lopez, what have you seen so far?
Well, you know, it's been a good, impressive day, you know, the first couple outings here of spring practice. Guys just getting in the groove of it, seeing sort of how the conditioning of the offseason has gone and how guys are transitioning, you know, really from a full set of winter workouts. I think a lot of eyes are on the defense right now. Cam Smith and Iman Marshall really going to be the leaders on the defense, especially at corner, a big position now. So how those guys kind of step up and take leadership roles along with Sam, you know, a lot of that senior leadership graduating, but still returning 14 seniors, I think that there's a lot to be said for how this team will grow over the spring practices.
Right, and that's what I'm looking at. We lost four captains, Max Brown transferring, two graduated, Adoree off to the draft. Not great for a team that's trying to make strides. You really want that veteran leadership to return, but I think that veteran leadership is in Clay Helton.
Yeah.
And I would like to see Clay Helton come back. He's working with Sam Darnold. We're super high hopes, obviously, for Sam Darnold. But we're going to be looking for players to step up and show that leadership in these spring practices when we come back in the fall.
And they'll need to do it now because expectations have never been higher. After
absolutely,
the finish last
after
season,
the Rose Bowl.
It's playoff or bust for us. And the young guys sort of stepping up and taking that leadership role right away, if it doesn't happen now in spring practice, it might not happen until it's too late. You can only turn around for so long when you're trying to make the playoff, and that's the expectation. You know, last season we had a little bit of leeway with leading off with Alabama. It'll be a tough season with no bye weeks, but also really no leeway for making mistakes early in the season.
Absolutely.
Well, we're going to go from the current USC players and whatnot back to Pro Day and Combine related stuff, but we're not talking about the real athletes. We're talking about the people on the desk right now.
No, but we're talking about the real
athletes.
We are the only real athletes.
The times were unofficial. The measurements were highly scandalous. But the performances were jaw-dropping. The cooler Combine, something to truly behold. This was a great time.
It was a good time. Yeah.
And we're actually going to roll. We have some highlights, a great video that Eduardo put together on this. Just check it out.
You're ahead of the line.
We're here today at the Water Cooler Combine. Filmed on the streets of South Central Los Angeles, this combine will show off the best of the worst, our hosts and producers pushing their bodies to the limit. We start with a 40-yard dash. Josh Cohen had a strong showing right off the bat, running a 4.75 on his second attempt. Michael Luisi put in a good effort, but his muscular hockey thighs and his flatbill hat added valuable seconds to his time. Grace Marlowe warned us that her right foot turns out when she runs, but man, it looked way weirder on video than we ever imagined, so thank you for that. Next up was the cone drill. Chris Lopez showed surprising agility in his run. Don't let those dad shoes fool you, this man has moves. Jess Green, she tried her hardest. She really did. Shout out to you, Jess. The effort is there. But again, the runaway winner was Josh Cohen. He channeled his inner Jameis Winston and swept the heat. I said he's strong then. Finally, the broad jump. Chris flew through the air like a puma attacking a gazelle, even though those two animals live in completely different biomes. John Marcus, despite a terrible starting stance, did terribly. There was no surprise there. I mean, what'd you expect? You started like 4 inches back, man. How about Jess? Once again, she really gave it her all. But did you see that handstand at the beginning of the video? That was pretty wild. So, congrats to Josh for being the overall winner of the Cooler Combine. We project him at number one draft pick by Sports Scene this fall.
How about the Cooler Combine? Unbelievable. Grace, what stood out to you? Whose performance? Not Luisi. Who you got?
Again, just not to reiterate the video, but real effort from Jess Green.
There it
effort
is.
From the girls here. Hard to do, like, you know, to cross the genders in this because, you know, I was excited about getting down to a six on my 40, and then I found out that's really bad.
Do you want to point out that you did officially have a faster 40 time than Darius Rogers?
That's not true.
NFL Pride.
We cannot confirm that. We ran on a sidewalk.
We can confirm that. As he crossed the line, he said, "Scouts in the trees."
Oh, no. Okay.
They're there.
On that note.
They're out there.
All right, I think we must shuffle this show right along to NFL free agency. None of that is true. So we move on to NFL free agency. Grace, I'll start with you. Which team boosted its stock the most this offseason?
Patriots had great offseason pickups. Extending Dante Hightower was kind of their one, like, keep it in the family move.
So,
and
yeah.
Everyone else, they're picking up people from other teams, really, like, solidifying that receiving core for Tom Brady, who is going to come back for another excellent year. Looking back over at losers, I think the biggest team in my mind right now is the Bears.
Okay.
The Bears have made some terrible
moves.
The most recent of which
they have the next Brock.
Mark Sanchez.
Oh, boy.
Oh, my God.
Well, so the Bears picked up the next Brock Osweiler and Mike Glennie. You heard it here first.
Yeah.
Giving him $15 million a year, probably not the smartest move, and overpaying for several guys like Marcus Weed and Marcus Cooper, but et cetera. The big winners for me, I actually look at the Cleveland Browns.
Absolutely.
Not someone who you normally know for actually succeeding in the NFL. We talk about the Brock Osweiler trade, picking up a second rounder for getting some of that cap space off the books, but most importantly, solidifying that offensive line. They picked up two top-flight offensive linemen from other teams, signed one of their own back. You saw the Cowboys really go from really bad to really good quickly by solidifying that offensive line. The next step up is going to be the Browns. If they can sort of add some mediocre skill players around that, if you can control the offensive line, you can do anything you want in this game.
Especially
and the Browns are building from exactly.
Next logical move.
So if and when they do bring a young quarterback into the system, there'll be offensive line to protect him. That'll be super important. A little bit of a homer move. My Detroit Lions have also buffed the offensive line, kept a lot of their key playmakers in there. I think that they've done a good job sort of building again that solid core of offensive front and then defensive guys in the back to sort of be able to build around what might be mediocre skill players. So that's really what free agency is about. It's about getting those bargains, getting those deals. I think that those teams have done that.
No question about it, Lopez. I've got Jacksonville, personally.
Okay.
A team that's won only 17 games in the past five seasons. They add Calais Campbell, shore up the defensive line.
True, good
AJ
pickup.
Boye from division rival Houston.
He'll be big.
And then they get Barry Church
from
the Cowboys. So not bad. They're really beefing up the defense. I like what Jacksonville did.
Yeah, only thing is, you know, when a lot of these bad teams kind of spend money, there's always the worry that when you go from a winning franchise to a perennial losing franchise, there's a lot of attitude change. There's a lot of once you get that contract, do you necessarily work as hard? Julius Thomas, I remember once upon a time, went from the Broncos to the Jags, has not been the same since, has not put up nearly the numbers that he once did with Peyton Manning. The 49ers, another franchise, losers of late that I'm looking at, overspending for players. They gave Malcolm Smith a huge contract where, as a USC homer, we like him, but is that kind of money going to a linebacker like him, who not even a three-down guy? Not sure if that's really the smartest investments they could be making. And then Brian Hoyer right now is their quarterback situation. No word on whether or not they'll make that trade for Kirk Cousins. So a lot of, you know, not a lot of teams sort of maybe floundering around that losing pattern. Also the big names not necessarily moving around.
Absolutely. We're looking at Adrian Peterson. We haven't heard anything from Tony Romo after that really sputtered out.
Thought we would.
Looking still at the Texans and the Broncos as the top choices to pick him up. But Adrian Peterson, really the biggest issue with people wanting to pick him up is that salary he's asking for.
Yeah.
What is it, $83-84 million?
He's never going to get
you
that as
spend
a running
that?
Back.
There's
especially
no
not
chance.
As a 31-year-old.
Get a young guy in the draft.
Yeah,
I think
exactly.
Is the argument.
No,
how
yeah,
many guys can you get for that amount of money?
It'll
who
never
haven't
be worth
been injured, who might have that potential.
I would be surprised if Adrian Peterson gets more in a one-year deal. Yeah. You only take a rental on a guy on a running back who's 31 years old. Doesn't matter how game-changing he is, especially when, frankly, his best years are behind him.
Do you see him lowering his own stock?
We'll see.
And getting signed?
I think the attitude's an issue. We'll see going forward.
A lot of stuff still up in the air in the NFL offseason. What is not up in the air? It's whether or not the U.S. is going to win its first World Baseball Classic.
They
dismantled Puerto Rico 8-0 right down the road at Dodger Stadium the other night. Really exciting stuff. But we have to kind of, again, pan out and look at this event and say, what does it mean for the sport in general?
Well, I think the World Baseball Classic is an interesting event where, you know, the U.S. won, and I think the MLB is trying to sell this as, you know, a big event to sort of lead into the season every 4 years, kind of the World Cup-ish of soccer. Only problem is, you know, soccer, everyone knows you care about the World Cup. You don't have to work on that from a marketing standpoint, but the World Baseball Classic kind of working on that. A lot of the small Latin countries like Puerto Rico, Puerto Rico was really into it, and they didn't even end up winning, and that's, I think, causing a little bit of conflict amongst players as to what to make of this tournament.
Absolutely. Looking at, especially the way that this tournament is timed. Looking at the way that this is timed, it's right in the middle of March Madness. So you have to imagine that they're going for some baseball offseason fans here. After that Cubs World Series, this is like kind of a whimper after a bang.
It's true.
And it's, like you said, a lot of players playing with passion on these teams. We get a lot of the top prospects from the Dominican Republic, from Puerto Rico, from all over South America, really. And now that they're allowed to have their own teams, it's like the U.S. is kind of a party pooper here. Well, and we won!
And the issue is we are the party pooper, and the event is really being tried to be sold to us. You know, we're the main market for this, but it seems like
we're the main TV market for anything.
All of the smaller countries enjoy it more, getting more out of it from a team, from a fan perspective.
Absolutely.
But that's not the media goal, what the MLB is trying to do. And then you have players criticizing the event. You had Yadier Molina criticizing the security and sort of the infrastructure of the event around it. You know, a lot of, you know, work to be done to really bring this event to a premium level like I know they want to be at. We'll see a lot of interesting developments, I think, going forward on this.
In a very interesting sports time of year, you got a lot of big stuff, March Madness, the cooler combine, and also the continuous rise of a certain LaVar ball. That and more coming up after the break. Let them hate. Watch the link and navigate. If they touch
Josh,
and wipe them.
Josh, we're live.
I don't believe you. They touch and wipe them off. Fingerprints, they take them off. Water cooler. Who is the frattiest QB?
I mean, it's obviously Matt Stafford. Have you ever seen anyone play in the NFL with a beer gut? The answer is obvious.
It's Peyton Manning.
How is it Peyton Manning?
It's Peyton Manning, because Peyton Manning looks like a 40-year-old dude that comes back to your
like
tailgates and hands all the 18-year-old girls a beer. He's hanging out like he's there all the time for no reason, not even on alumni weekend.
He doesn't have an appreciation for good alcohol.
Peyton Manning's balding. How many frat guys have you know that aren't balding?
It's just not a possibility.
Save some talk for the show. The Water Cooler, Fridays at 2:30, right here on Trojan Vision.
All right, everybody, welcome to Objection. I am here with Chris Lopez and Kendrick Ree, two of our NBA experts, and today we're going to be talking about one of the biggest no-names in sports. It's LaVar Ball. So, Kendrick, we'll have you lead off. You're in support. Tell us why you like the guy.
Completely. I love the man. I think he's a great, great parent, great role model to his kids. Recently, there's been a lot of controversy, so many haters. Why do people hate on this man?
Tell me why. All he's doing is raising his kids.
I mean, let's look at the facts.
He's raising his kids.
He's raising three of his kids, LiAngelo, LaMelo, and Lonzo, with Lonzo being in UCLA right now. All three of the Ball brothers committed to UCLA. Lonzo's playing right now. He's been on Skip and Shannon. He's been on Colin Cowherd, promoting his brand, explaining. And I feel like once you looked at those interviews, once you watched those interviews, you get a better sense of what he's saying. Like, you understand where he's coming from.
Do you think that a brand should include someone's children?
The man is saying outlandish claims. So, oh, my son is better than Steph Curry. Oh, I could beat Charles Barkley. I could beat Michael Jordan. That's exactly the reaction he wants.
And he made...
He wants people like you and you to be so... And he made so one, angered.
He made one crucial...
It's like the Donald Trump effect,
he made one crucial mistake. A little bit, yes. But he made one crucial
mistake.
What
is a crucial mistake?
And that was stepping to the man who is currently the most powerful person in the league, and that is LeBron James. To be in the league to flourish business-wise, you said building a brand.
Yes.
Who is the most powerful brand in the NBA right now?
Who is the most powerful brand in them? LeBron or Kobe.
Is it a good idea to put a target on your back for the most powerful brand in the league? Especially when you talk about someone's kids, because that makes it personal. This isn't about business. Now LeBron has a personal problem with you. Do you think that puts Lonzo in a good position or the other kids?
So Lonzo aside, looking at LaMelo and LiAngelo, do you think that they will flourish as well as Lonzo did without a camera on him? Because obviously we've seen 92-point games, committed to UCLA. Now their dad is number one in the spotlight. Do you think that a player can grow up and grow into what Lonzo has become? Obviously different players, but brothers, and we have to look at them under the same lens. Do you think that LiAngelo and LaMelo can be as good as Lonzo?
Skill-wise? Yes. I mean, at this rate, I mean, the 14-year-old kid scored 92 points in a high school game. That's absolutely ludicrous. They're what, 14, and his older brother's what, 17? Already UCLA commits. I mean, they're just not going to take any random people. They're going to take you if you have talent. And obviously, these college scouts have seen his talent from this age. And yes, skill-wise, I feel like they'll do very well, if not better than Lonzo.
Looking at Lonzo Ball and the way that LaVar has worked with him, I was also coached by my dad on a volleyball team, on a high school volleyball team. I know LaVar has said he is not in the gym, he's not bugging UCLA, whatever. But the way that LaVar Ball coaches Lonzo makes me think that he sees a potential that he could have had, and he is not concerned about his son to get that potential. He is not concerned about his son as a person. Do you think Lonzo could have said, hey, Dad, I want to go play trumpet? And he would have let him do it?
Do you think he enjoys trumpet?
Maybe he does.
LaVar said in his interview.
I mean,
he said,
I would like to hear what Lonzo said.
All right.
The way that my dad worked with me as a volleyball player was so that I could be the best volleyball player I could be. And then when I was done playing volleyball, he said, go be the best person you can be. And I do not think LaVar Ball feels that way. However, the man's built a business, so glad I'm not his kid. This has been Objection. Thanks for tuning in.
And welcome back to the Water Cooler, everybody. In case you're just joining us, yeah, we're not in Studio B. We are in the great outdoors.
In the wilderness.
That's it. The Water Cooler host, Grace and Chris. We got Trevor Denton as well. One second, though. We got to get to...
Rev.
Your bout with Kendrick. Yes. How are you guys doing after that?
Well, so I thought it was an honorable bout, first of all. I like that he had some good points. He stuck to them. I can appreciate that. And I saw where he was coming from. You know, LaVar Ball getting a lot of criticism on a lot of fronts. But at the end of the day, I think that he's just a guy spewing things and has no real pedigree for what he's saying. He only averaged 2.2 points in 1 year of college. So he played 1 year of college ball. That's not a lot for you to say that you're an expert on basketball, especially when you're comparing yourself to the greats of the game, the top 0.001% of players who have ever played basketball. I don't think that you really hold up and can say that you know versus those guys and could have taken them on as prime. But hey, he's doing a good job marketing a brand, and I guess I can respect that as a business major, businessman to businessman. So there's only so much you can say.
I gotta call myself out real quick for maybe being a biased mediator, because I am not a fan either.
It's an idea for a weekly segment. As is, did he or she actually say that? Our first one is LaVar Ball, and Trevor Denton joins us on the desk.
Ready to talk some more LaVar?
Let's get this thing
going. Absolutely, let's go.
Basically, how this is going to work
my
is
guy.
I'm going to read a quote, and you guys are going to tell me if LaVar Ball really said it or not. Ready?
Right, sounds good.
Let's go. You're actually in this one. Let's go, man. All right, first one. To make me cry, you've got to hit me with a 2x4. Did LaVar Ball say that?
Oh, absolutely. I think he definitely
yes.
said that.
Strong no.
No,
we're going yes.
Boom!
LaVar Ball did say that.
He did say that.
He did say that.
Let's go!
He said it. I'm writing it down. Lopez.
He said it.
Josh, 1 point.
He only reacts to extreme events. Being hit by a 2x4 is like the 1980s version of like getting knocked out.
That's one I actually believe. All right, number two. I'm undefeated in 1-on-1.
No, he didn't say that because he said something else.
Yeah, better television. Yes, he said it.
No.
He said it. He said it on first take. Said it.
He cannot be undefeated. He has a son that's way better than he'll ever be.
All right, number three.
Yeah, but his points count for twice Lonzo's points.
That's it. Oh, man. LaVar Ball.
I'm 0-2.
All right, next one. To me, Lonzo is the best player in the world, including LeBron James and Russell Westbrook. He can beat anyone 1-on-1. Did he say it?
Statistically, it has to be no.
I feel like yes. I feel like yes. Trevor's stacking the deck one, and that sounds like something he'd say. That's the attitude he's building.
I feel like no, but that is a future quote. I'm saying within the week he says it.
This is actually a no. The actual quote was, except for LeBron James and Russell Westbrook, Lonzo can beat anyone in 1-on-1. These are pretty tricky.
Hey, that's a trick question.
It was a trick question.
To the professor after this.
You
all right?
did. I should, absolutely.
Back. That's an SAT question.
Trick question. All right, two more questions. If Lonzo was on the Warriors, no way they lose a 3-1 lead. He has that clutch gene Curry just doesn't have.
That's absolutely true. That sounds like, I think I've heard that one before.
All right, last one. If Lonzo was a host of Water Cooler, the show would be live on campus every week, and it'd be the highest rated show in the LA area. Did LaVar say it?
I think that was Donald Trump.
Yeah, that sounds like a LaVar quote. I'll take a yes on that.
Well, LaVar Ball did not say it.
Gotta bring him on the show.
LaVar Ball did not say it, but thanks for playing, guys.
Absolutely. Thanks so much, T-Rev. Good quotes there. I can't believe we didn't say a third one. Come back next week.
I'm sure we'll have like a whole new crop to choose from.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Sounds good.
What an incredible game. For more basketball, we have the crew, including Trevor, comparing some dynasties.
Luis Vidari here with Trevor Denton, Kendrick Reed, to talk about more NBA hoops, past versus present. Two dynasties that could have been. The 1990s Orlando Magic featured Penny Hardaway and Shaquille O'Neal with a strong supporting cast, and the early 2000s Oklahoma City Thunder features a star-studded core of James Harden, Kevin Durant, and Russell Westbrook. Which team had more of a potential to create a dynasty?
Well, I have my answer, and I definitely think it's the Orlando Magic. Look, they had Shaquille O'Neal, young Shaquille O'Neal, before he gained a lot of weight. He was the most athletic rebounder in the game, very good scorer. He was averaging like 29 points early on. And they had Penny Hardaway, who many at the time were calling the next Magic Johnson, a 6'7 point guard. A 6'7 point guard who could score and pass and a triple-double threat. I mean, I think this team could have been the next Chicago Bulls.
The next Chicago Bulls.
Yes, I think they could have been a dynasty.
A dynasty.
A dynasty, absolutely.
Got swept in the finals.
You're going with Thunder.
I mean, if you look at the 2012 OKC lineup, who do you have? Let's see. Kevin Durant.
MVP.
All right.
In my opinion, second best player right now.
Sure.
You have, what was his name again? Russell Westbrook, triple-double machine. People comparing him to Oscar Robertson.
Uh-huh.
And then, who was that other triple-double? Oh, James Harden.
All right. You bring up James Harden, and that's fair. But James Harden on the 2012 Oklahoma City Thunder is not the James Harden now. He even said that if he had stayed on the Thunder, he's not sure if he would become the same player. He needed to be on his own to become that triple-double threat. Yeah. At the time, he was averaging 16.8. And look, we can talk about Shaq and Penny. We'll talk about Shaq and Penny a lot. But the Magic also had a really, really good supporting cast.
I mean, okay, Penny Hardaway at the end of his career, all said and done, averaged 15-5-4. Modest
injuries,
numbers.
Injuries.
And if we're talking which team could have had the dynasty, and we're looking right now in the current, Harden and Westbrook are 1 and 2 right now in the MVP voting unanimously,
fair,
right?
Fair.
So we're saying they're like 27, 28 right now, and they're only getting better. Whereas obviously Shaquille O'Neal, his whole career was dominant, won multiple rings, but Penny Hardaway never was MVP, only All-NBA twice, only a couple All-Stars, didn't turn out to the player that Harden, Westbrook, and Durant have all become.
Well, the thing is, the Magic fulfilled their potential very early on. Shaq was only in his third year when they made the finals. Penny was in his second. But then an injury to Penny and then Shaq leaving to the Lakers completely destroyed it. I think this team could have won 3 or 4 rings. Look, they beat the Chicago Bulls. They beat a Jordan-led Chicago Bulls in the conference finals in 1995. This was a very, very good team. They had veterans. They had Horace Grant. They had young guys. This team, Oklahoma City Thunder, were not fully developed. And they had chances. They had plenty of chances. But together, they just never got it done.
I think if Harden didn't leave to Houston after they lost in the 2012 finals, two rings.
Two rings?
I see two rings.
All right, so maybe not quite a dynasty.
Not a dynasty. How many years do you think a dynasty is? 3 years?
I think a dynasty has got to be at least three rings. Got to be at least three rings.
It's hard.
What do you think? How many rings for the Thunder?
I'd say I'd agree 2 or 3, but I do think that they would have been there every year, necessarily like competing with LeBron, competing with all these superstars, the Warriors right now. They would have been in the conference finals, the NBA finals, and that's why they would have been a dominant power.
And everyone was young. Everyone was very young. Harden, 22 years old. Durant, 23. I feel like if they matured, if they played longer with each other and mature and gained experience, they would have a much higher chance of winning rings together.
I think the main question for the Thunder is how James Harden would have been used. Because would he have been given the chance? Would he have been given the chance that he has with Houston
to
become a dominant scorer?
Point.
Because you had Russell yeah. scoring a lot already. He was already averaging close to 25
yeah,
early
25,
on. Durant,
yeah.
as you said, was averaging 28.
Yes.
They had Harden coming off the bench. They didn't know how to use him.
Yeah.
Whereas the Magic were maximizing the talent they had at the time. They knew how to play together. And I think if the injury to Penny didn't happen and Shaq didn't leave, I just think it's a more dominant dynasty.
Well, lots of what-ifs questions. We'll never truly know what the Magic could have been or what the Thunder could have been. But it's fair to say that all these players in their own regard had successful careers. And that those teams, maybe they would have been all-time dynasties, but we'll never truly know.
Welcome back to the Outdoor Desk. Here with a special edition of the Water Cooler. More
Still
basketball.
Outdoors.
Great work there by that trio. And
fighting Mother Nature.
We're now talking Russ, looking more and more probable that he's going to break Oscar Robertson's record of averaging a triple-double in a season. Would be a remarkable accomplishment, but Grace, does it mean anything to you?
You know, I personally don't really think it means as much as he would like it to. Yeah. I feel like Russ is on a solo mission instead of a team quest here. He is not elevating the status of his team. I mean, they're in the playoffs. Look at James Harden in comparison. Harden averaging triple-doubles on and off. It's not as flashy, but his team is far higher seeded.
Okay, but so he also is surrounded by much better players who understand their role better. I would say it's working with peanuts versus an actual established team. Russ elevates his team more than any other player in the league. And you can just tell by his teammates and the fact that they all back him up that he does a pretty good job for them.
But I don't feel like breaking a triple-double record is necessarily... Do you feel like that's his focus? Because I do. I feel like he's completely focused on the record, not necessarily the playoffs right now.
I mean, I think he's focused on just keeping it at 100 miles per hour all the time as much as he can. And in the course of that, he would like to break the triple-double record, yes. But, I mean, you'll see he's also doing everything on defense. He does everything for that team as much as he can. He has the highest usage rate and the highest pretty much every kind of single contributor rate he can, whether or not it contributes to his triple-doubles. This is building the legacy of what is Russell Westbrook. When Kevin Durant left him, a lot of people kind of left him for dead. Thought that he might go the way of Steve Francis and be one of those forgotten stars on a beleaguered franchise. He's kept them competitive in the West, really against all odds. I mean, Victor Oladipo is his number two, and he still is able to challenge teams. So
Josh, you got a thought on that? Josh?
Me likes Victor.
Okay,
go on.
But in terms of number twos, Now, James Harden is working with Trevor Ariza. He's working with better bigs, or maybe not better bigs, but he has Lou Williams now coming off the bench. I think that James Harden has a better system and a whole better infrastructure around him, which is why he's able to do what he does. Russ is still treading new water, being a trailblazer in his own right, and what an NBA player can and can't do and what's possible.
I just feel like other players are more likely to have an easier route to the triple-double record. And I feel like the amount of triple-doubles he's had indicates to me, however much it indicates to me that he is a fantastic player, that he is doing all of that for his team, it also indicates to me, why isn't anyone else doing that? Why doesn't LeBron have these numbers?
Because he's not only focused on other things, but he doesn't
play. He's focused on getting to the playoffs.
Well, no, he's focused on resting for the playoffs. No one keeps it at 100 miles an hour like Russ does. There's no one who game in and game out.
You cannot deny that, but is he going 100 for the playoffs or for the triple-double record?
He just goes 100. He doesn't know any other way to play the game.
I doubt that.
LeBron takes plays off.
I highly doubt that.
LeBron rests. He takes plays off. He'll take games off. I don't know if Russ ever does that. Now, James Harden doesn't either, but I think they play with the same attitude, just a little bit of a different strategy.
I'm still going with James Harden as a far more efficient player.
No one thought Russell ever could have done this at the beginning of the season. And he's done it, and he's
defied
our expectations. I think everyone cares.
About the triple-double record?
A lot of people care.
Well, we'll wrap this conversation up, but I'll just go ahead and say that Victor Oladipo, who's your daddy, could average a quadruple-double every night if he wanted to.
Yeah, Russ,
with that, we move on to the playoff race. 3 weeks and one day until the NBA postseason. We are gearing up. We're going to start out in the East. Who's in, who's out? Lopez?
Well, it looks like the, who's at that AC? Not the Chicago
Miami
Bulls.
Miami Heat have a horrible finishing stretch. They have been pushing through the last few games, but oh my God, they play the Wizards twice, they play the Raptors twice, and they play the Cavs once.
Oh.
In that last 11-10 games, that is a shot to the head.
Oh yeah, no.
Oh my God. They have a few throwaway games. I mean, they've got the Nuggets, tough game. They got the Knicks, easy game. But that's at least three losses out of those five.
Well, probably, but nonetheless, maybe the best coaching job in the entire league.
Very
Eric Spoelstra turning around. They started out 10-30 during the year and have gone 30-10 down the stretch, playing some of the best basketball of anyone with Dion Waiters as their number one scorer. That deserves to be awarded in and of itself. I hope they keep the AC just to see him in the playoffs, but looking sort of more to the top part of the bracket.
Right.
I like that the Cavs actually have contenders now. I think that the Raptors and the Celtics have a chance to give them a little trouble. The Cavs maleaguered a little bit, 4-6 in their last 10. LeBron calling them out right before the playoffs. If they even have a little bit of a bump, there's a chance that they could be worn down going into the finals. Maybe a team upsets them. I'm really excited to see the Eastern Conference Finals.
Just like the Warriors, we've seen the Cavs have some significant upsets. And that's why I think it's so fun to watch this very stacked field and say, there could be an 8-1 upset this year. There could be a 2-7, absolutely getting into the Eastern and Western Conference Finals. I think this is the most exciting prospect we've had in the East in a long time. It used to be that it was basically the Cavs or the Heat, and then it was no one.
Yeah.
Or the Celtics, whichever dynasty was working at the time, but players are putting in work.
Yeah, well, teams have built themselves now to play small and big with the Ibaka trade, as we talked about before. The Toronto is now flexible enough to sort of handle any playoff situation they'll be thrown into. So I like that the teams are sort of preparing for the style of play the Cavs will be bringing on the West. The top bracket, we'll see some trouble in the playoffs. We'll see where it goes.
I say it every week in the West. If the playoffs started today, Denver would be in, and they'd be playing the Warriors. With that, we move on to
that.
A new trend or a resurgent trend from way back in the day about flat earthers. We'll talk about the championship. We'll get there. But first, flat earthers. Kyrie, a guy who wants the championship, doesn't think the earth is round. This problem continues. Guys, what's going on? You look incredulous. I too am confused.
I hate that we've gotten to the point where I think we got to shoot some NBA stars into space.
Oh, man. This gives me more heartburn than the tequila and Cabo. I tell you what. The fact that Shaq now came in support of this, someone who calls himself, the big Aristotle, someone who is known for at least occasionally saying something of some sort of merit.
So true.
This will, again, as I said with Kyrie, will now always poison my view of him. We talked about the JaVale McGee Shaq beef and how Shaq maybe got the best of that a little bit. Now Shaq has firmly supplanted himself in the bum category. There is nothing JaVale McGee can do on the court will make him more of a bum than Shaq thinking the earth is flat. There is nothing. There's no possible way. Shaq has now put himself at the bottom of the ladder. Nothing he says matters anymore. Charles Barkley is now the second smartest person on that bracket. Well, I guess EJ's second smartest. But either way, he's no longer last, and that is an accomplishment. Shaq is Shaqed and a fool.
You know, I really have nothing to follow that up with, except for I think the public education system might have failed us here.
Okay.
It is weird.
Where are their teachers? If you're Shaq's elementary school teacher?
They gotta come out of the woodwork.
What are you doing?
You gotta blow this up.
Oh my God.
It is weird seeing a lot of these opinions now getting thrown out. I think that they should bring maybe a actual scientist onto the show. Maybe bring DeGrasse or Bill Nye.
Bill Nye
on to just explain very simply, very succinctly how that doesn't make any sense, just so we can put it on display and put all of this to rest. Because only those two have said something. You never know who else is thinking it. This is concerning now. I'm worried about how many flat earthers there are in the NBA.
The All-Star
team. And I thought they were the progressive league. All-Star
league team.
Theories that the earth is flat should be things of the past. Things that are always things of the future. March Madness, coming up next. Let them hate. Watch the link and navigate. If they touch
Josh,
and wipe them.
Josh, we're live.
I don't believe you. They touch and wipe them off. Fingerprints, they take them off. Water cooler. Who is the frattiest QB?
I mean, it's obviously Matt Stafford. Have you ever seen anyone play in the NFL with a beer gut? The answer is obvious.
It's Peyton Manning.
How is it Peyton Manning?
It's Peyton Manning, because Peyton Manning looks like a 40-year-old dude that comes back to your tailgate and hands all the 18-year-old girls a beer. No, he's hanging out like he's there all the time for no reason, not even on alumni weekend.
He doesn't have an appreciation for good alcohol.
Peyton Manning's balding. How many frat guys do you know that aren't balding?
Save some talk for the show. The Water Cooler, Fridays at 2:30, right here on Trojan Vision.
John, the EP of the show, now joins us. He knew that, you knew that future reference was coming with March Madness.
100%.
Yeah. So we're going to start out with John, the UNC fan.
Naturally.
We're going to start out in the South with UNC Butler. Heavyweight bout, Sweet 16 matchup, what you got?
Yeah, you know, bracketology, you know, is just one of my favorite things. I got first 18 games right, and, you know, the South was my favorite bracket, getting all that.
First 18 games, big deal.
Wow.
What percentile are you in now?
The 40th percentile now, so I really
can't. Yeah, well, I bet John watched all the games.
There you go.
Yeah, all right, well, you know, UNC versus Butler. Butler's been, I think, an upset team, even though they were a 4 seed. I really think they were
always
overranked.
Absolutely.
I really do. I thought they could have lost to Winthrop even in that first game. But you know what? They have fought on. I think they'll put up the toughest matchup UNC's had pretty much all March Madness.
Okay.
I think UNC takes this to move on to the
Elite Eight. Just escaped against Arkansas, but I too also have UNC. I think, you know, the pace is just going to be able to wear them out.
I would completely agree. I feel like Butler, while being a team that can battle, can't match up this well against a 1 seed. I think UNC is one of the most legit 1 seeds we see in the tournament. I mean, we've had some shuffling around. I'm a little worried we're going to get ice bucket challenged.
Yeah, if Butler wins,
for taking the top
cool,
eight,
is the issue.
So a little
I'm a little concerned.
A little update. We had a bet pretty much a couple weeks ago, and, well, it was either pick the number 1 or 2 seed in any bracket or the field, and right now the field's actually looking pretty good.
We still got 2 of 8, all right? I'm relaxed. I got Kansas to win it all anyway, so I'm feeling good.
There you go. Oh, I'm picking Butler. Team that went 2-0 against Villanova this season, and a team, I think, that is going to channel its inner Gordon Hayward against the Tar Heels and knock them off. We're going to stay in the South now. A
hot
rematch
take
from a game earlier this year. It's UCLA and it's Kentucky. Ooh. Grace, who you got?
I have UCLA. Lonzo Ball is on a tear. His name is everywhere right now, but he's thriving, and I think that's very impressive for a player that young. He's shooting 76% through these first few games. How is that possible?
For a
he
guard.
Almost had a triple-double. He is playing lights out. He's leading the team through. He is not listening to anything that anyone, I guess he's listening to his dad or not. We'll never know.
Yeah.
Anyways, UCLA is playing with great momentum. I think that they're really going to push back at Kentucky.
Yeah.
Great matchup for them.
Most complete team not named Kansas. I also have UCLA. I really like them going forward.
Yeah, I got to go with UCLA too. You know, as much as we are USC fans, I really do.
It makes us sick, but they're just so good.
They're good.
Lopez just mentioned the top team in the country. According to many pundits out there, Kansas, they get a very, very good Oregon team in an Elite Eight matchup. Lopez.
Oh, I still got KU in this. I think that Oregon, you know, has sort of skated by a couple of teams weaker than them. I think when you run into a juggernaut like Kansas, the top seed in the tournament, I like Frank Mason to absolutely dominate this game. I know Tyler Dorsey's look good, but Frank Mason has been consistently the guard that Tyler Dorsey is occasionally, and I like the overall talent, especially Josh Jackson. I like him as a Swiss Army knife to really take out Oregon.
100% Kansas. I feel like Oregon, looking at Zona, who just lost to Xavier, the Pac-12 has been kind of patchy.
The Pac-12, if you look at last year, all but one team lost in the first round.
Right.
The other one being Oregon, but the other ones all got obliterated, whether it was Cal or SC. Mm-hmm. They all lost in that first round.
Yeah, I fully agree that Oregon has had kind of an easy road up to here. Kansas is not
Kansas
moving.
Is riding high right now. They are the strongest team in the tournament.
It's a brutal takedown.
Kansas team that has scored 90-plus points in all three tournament games so far. Now a game that not everyone picked. It's Wisconsin, an 8 seed, against Florida, a 4 seed. John?
You know, I really like Wisconsin. I really think that I had that Villanova upset, and I'm really happy that actually came through. That's the only one I will brag about, as much as I have been bragging a lot already.
But
you know what? You know what? Endorse me on LinkedIn for bracketology. That's what I'm good at, okay?
Marketing.
This is what I have to say. Wisconsin can do this. I think they have a Final Four potential, a championship run.
Yeah.
You know, they're good. They might not have Frank Kaminsky, but
they have the experience. I really like Nigel Hayes. I think he's a savvy veteran who really make the clutch plays down the stretch. A crucial big man in games like this is really important to win in the tournament.
No question about it. Also, Baylor and South Carolina, big one in the East. Now to the West, an Elite Eight matchup. It's Gonzaga and Xavier. Xavier, an 11 seed, still alive. John?
I got to go with Xavier. You know, they've just been fighting all the way through. They're that 11 seed. They're that Cinderella team left. There's no 12 seeds left. Middle Tennessee didn't do it. I'm going with Xavier all the way to the Final Four.
All right, well, you're wrong. So I'm going to go with Gonzaga. Gonzaga's showing in that win over West Virginia, they have had naysayers the entire way, and they show that they can grind out wins. Jordan Matthews with that go-ahead three in the last minute, they have proven they have the mental fortitude to take down Xavier. Xavier riding high off a win against Arizona, but I think that they're going to come into this a little cocky.
But I would say Gonzaga deserves some of those naysayers. They've been to the tournament, the last 10 years?
Yeah.
Last 10 years, they have shown a solid, reputation for not being able to perform late in the tournament. I think Xavier, even though an 11 seed, they have not played like an 11 seed at all, dismantled Florida State by 25, which I'm still impressed about.
They
didn't really seem to miss a step in the last game. Trevor Blewett, possibly one of the player of the tournaments. I really think that sort of they have the flexibility to take on any kind of team. I think they out-athletic and out-shoot Gonzaga, which is normally their strength.
Unless that
big beard lumberjack is able to pull down 20 rebounds, I absolutely like Xavier.
Worth noting with Xavier, their star guard, Edmund Sumner, went down with a torn ACL midway through the year. They were underranked. They're still alive. Watch out for the Musketeers. Will they win it all? I don't know. Lopez, who do you think wins it all?
You know, I do like Xavier's chance with, you know, one of those top flight, you know, guys who controls games like Trevor Blewett, but I have Kansas in this. We mentioned it a little bit earlier, but you go down the line, really players 1 through 6 on Kansas, that's the best 6 players in the country. Frank Mason up for player of the year, Devontae Graham really controlling the outside, being a tremendously athletic shooting guard, and Josh Jackson, I think, is the player that no one can handle. He is a better version of Dylan Brooks in the sense that he can play outside, inside, also an underrated defender. If Lucas can control the inside and the boards, maybe take on a guy like Baylor's big man and really be able to patrol that.
Jordan Bell.
Jordan or Motley. So if he can defend players like that, think that they'll be able to advance.
And Motley's a hard player to contain. We saw him in USC's game, fouls out, still maybe has the biggest game impact of any player
really
on the court.
Yeah.
I've already talked about my pick. I am going with UCLA. My uncle Jake would be so proud of me right now. Bruins alum, 69.
But no one on this campus is. Just so you know.
No one on this campus is happy with me, but just look at how this team's playing. They're playing with all this momentum. I love the South. I think the South has been like the true fight.
It really has. It's been the most stacked bracket. It is the most difficult road to the Final Four.
Absolutely.
Kentucky, UCLA, North Carolina, even Arkansas, they put up a great fight. They beat Seton Hall. Seton Hall should have won that game.
I think this win over Kentucky is going to be easy for UCLA, and I think it's going to be that way because they had 18 turnovers the first time they played and beat Kentucky.
It's true.
They have been handling the ball amazingly during the NCAA tournament. They're peaking at the right time.
Would have picked them, but we go to a certain college where I couldn't let myself pick them.
Well, that makes you a bad sports commentator.
I just can't. I don't like homers at all, but we go to this school. You are a current student of this school. How dare you?
How could you?
John, find me after the show. Catch me outside. We're already outside.
All right, well, you know what? I like my Final Four, Wisconsin, Xavier, Kansas, UNC, but you know what? Joel Berry, Justin Jackson, they're a strong team. I don't think
I know he'd pick UNC?
Well, then hear me out. I haven't picked them yet.
I might.
If they lose, you know we're going to
win. I'm in
suspense.
But
you know what? What has North Carolina's crux been in their Roy Williams saga is the former school of Roy Williams, Kansas. Bill Self is there.
True.
The last time they met in the Final Four, Kansas dismantled them by 19. I could see that happening again. I could see Kansas pulling that off. That wouldn't be an upset. Kansas is probably favored to win that game.
Top seed.
Yeah. They're the overall number one seed left at this rate. So you look at, I think Xavier, Wisconsin, that's a toss-up. I don't really care about that. But in that final.
Self-proclaimed bracketology expert does not really care about that final game. You heard it here.
But you know what?
Hot take.
Kansas or UNC, I'm going to go with UNC just because the gut, because I'm going to go with that team that I just root for. But you know what? No. Kansas. I'm going to go with Kansas wins it all.
Let's go with the brain. Nice.
Wow, the
I
deep
like the
wind
pick.
Came out of the like the pick. Came out of the south.
Yeah. Mother Nature may be reacting to that. We'll see more on that later.
It's the water cooler. Yeah. It's outside, and we fade our own picks on air. Stay tuned for more. We are going to take a quick break, but USC Hoops and more coming up.
Thanks for having me.
Let them hate. Watch the link and navigate. If they touch
Josh,
and wipe them.
Josh, we're live.
I don't believe you.
They touch and wipe them off. Fingerprints, they take them off.
Water cooler.
Who is the frattiest QB?
I mean, it's obviously Matt Stafford. Have you ever seen anyone play in the NFL with a beer gut? The answer is obvious.
It's Peyton Manning.
How is it Peyton Manning?
It's Peyton Manning, because Peyton Manning looks like a 40-year-old dude that comes back to your tailgate and hands all the 18-year-old girls a beer. No, he's hanging out like he's there all the time for no reason, not even on alumni weekend.
He doesn't have an appreciation for good alcohol.
Peyton Manning's balding. How many frat guys do you know that aren't balding?
Save some talk for the show. The Water Cooler, Fridays at 2:30, right here on Trojan Vision.
And welcome back into the water cooler, the outdoor water cooler on this beautiful Friday afternoon, right in the heart of the USC campus. We got to talk about USC basketball, just about a week removed from the tragedy against Baylor, the Bears advancing past USC. But USC really made its mark on a national scale in this tournament, the postseason run that these fans really craved. With that win over SMU in that second game, USC had 13 games this season in which they were trailing by 10 or more points at some point in the game. Truly remarkable. My question, though, for you, Grace, is once again, does it mean anything to you when you look at that stat?
You know, what that means, everything that it means is immediate, and it doesn't roll into next season, which is what's interesting about it. I watched the first half of our Providence game, and then I had to do homework, and so I turned off the second half because I thought, oh, well, there it goes. And right before I turned it off, they played that stat. They played that exact stat you just read, and I thought, oh, that's interesting. Yeah. So in immediacy, it's important because you have teams who get down and don't get stuck in a mental hole. However, it's more of a comment on coaching than it is on players. I would love to see us not dig ourselves into a
hole.
That
would be nice.
And be like this comeback team, because that to me just says, wow, you really prepared poorly.
Yeah, so for me, it's a little bit of kind of a bittersweet double-edged sword kind of issue, because going into the tournament, I feel like we all were a little underwhelmed by the whole season of performance. We came in hot out of the non-conference schedule, 15-0, and then through the Pac-12 schedule, we sputtered a little bit, I think a little bit more than last year. And going into the Pac-12 tournament, I don't think we were very impressed with our performance. So we make a couple of good late runs in the tournament and are able to pull off, again, a long line of comebacks during the year. But is that really the kind of consistent step forward that we were hoping for from last year? I know we talked about Metu wanting to be that inside presence developing from freshman to sophomore that we sort of didn't necessarily see when
until
big men
the
from
tournament.
UCLA, even during the tournament, he didn't do a great job controlling the paint. I don't know if a lot of the
controlling
younger
the
guys
paint,
took
no,
that
cutting
step forward.
Better.
Cutting better, but defensively specifically, guys like Motley were destroying us in the paint.
I was about to say that Baylor game was a huge,
Metu put up a lot of points in that game, but rebounds, Motley was really dominant, especially on the offensive boards, and that's ultimately what ended up costing us, an offensive rebound late in the game. And these are really the signs of a mature program, a program that's sort of able to, 1-5, be able to stop these mistakes. We'll have one or two guys really catch fire. Elijah Stewart put up a 20-30-point game, but can we do this now consistently without sort of those, like, big spark explosion kind of things? I'm worried about sort of taking the next step now again, where we get a little bit lucky in the tournament, have a couple of impressive games at the end of the year,
but don't win.
Will we be able to ever have that mature, like, program program and a complete team. I'm going to get De'Anthony Melton to take a leadership role now. I don't know which of these guys will leave, if Benny Boatwright will take a step forward, because you know, we were hoping for a lot of this year, and we're kind of just left waiting again.
Absolutely, and I think that Andy Enfield maybe needs to take a look at why his players are really second-half players, and if he should be making whatever comeback speech he's making in the halftime locker room
just
before
lead
the
it
game.
Off. Lead it off with that.
Hey, guys, we're down by 20. We got to come back and just to start.
Overrated.
And then when it's 0-0, you're excited.
Yeah.
Overrated. USC starting out undefeated in non-conference play and then also finishing with a bang with that mini but very exciting postseason run. USC basketball continues that upward trajectory under head coach Andy Enfield. Once again, though, as we always do, even outside, we're going to pan out. We're going to look at the tournament as a whole, not just the Chemezi Metus, who were great for USC during that run through the dance. Run through the dance. I kind of like that. But we're going to look at all the players, the Josh Jacksons, the Frank Masons. Who you got for player of the tournament? It's not over yet, but so far.
Oh, absolutely, Trayvon Blewett. Ironic that a guy whose last name is Blewett has been maybe the most clutch player in this entire tournament. Guard for Xavier has just been nailing threes the entire tournament. He's been a absolute sharpshooter like he was during the regular season. But the most important thing I see is he averaged 18 points during the regular season, 25.5 points in the tournament. Yep. The guys who can really step their game up when the time matters most from what they were doing the regular season to now, I think that's really when the player of the tournament, so that's a big mark for me and something I really look for.
Absolutely, especially if you're looking at it in terms of the tournament, because Xavier wasn't a name.
Sure.
A lot of the names that I have written down are names we've already brought up. I'm looking at Lonzo Ball. I'm looking at Jonathan Motley, who if Baylor makes a push into the Final Four, could be an absolute contender.
Yeah,
he has such an important presence. And as you mentioned to me before the show, really the only big man who we've seen have a huge impact. And looking at guys in the NBA like Karl Anthony Towns, they are valued. They're very valued. Passing forwards like Nikola Jokic, players who can facilitate the ball and muscle up in the paint.
Yeah, no, he's really the only, I mean, Caleb Swearinger didn't necessarily play well in the tournament. A lot of guards, a lot of clutch long distance shots at the end of games like we're used to seeing, despite no buzzer beaters in this tournament. A little bit of an odd thing. There have been zero buzzer beaters this entire tournament despite three opportunities last night. So just these clutch shots down the stretch from important guards. A lot of seniors as well. A lot of these guys are old guys, been in the program for multiple years. When people talk about maybe the one and dones sort of destroying the game of college basketball, or at least lowering the level of play, you see a lot of the people who are highlighted in this tournament being seniors, old guys who have been there before.
Jonathan Motley's a beast, but I'm with you on Blewett. He's shooting 48% from beyond the arc in this tournament so far.
Also
darn impressive.
Prime, not to mention Frank Mason III.
Frank Mason III.
Prime.
Also just an unbelievable
The new
player.
Frank the Tank.
Frank
Kaminsky
the Tank
can watch out.
Frank the Tank plays for Kansas, never an underdog. But there are some underdogs who win. Middle Tennessee, we called it. Best upset so far.
One of us called it. That would be you. My best upset is definitely Xavier over Florida State. We've talked about Xavier a lot only because I think they've been one of the few highlights as a lower seed. But to play against a 3 seed that was one of the most athletic teams with future NBA players and dismantle them by 25, I mean, that was more than impressive. And I think was the biggest upset in the tournament.
This question's hard for me. I liked that Wisconsin win. I liked them sneaking to the bracket. I was really hoping that upset would be by USC. So I'm just, it's still a little close to my heart that we did not. I mean, that Baylor game could have been decided by, we've already gone into this. I don't need to get emotional on air. But maybe next year, 11 seed is always a good run, but I would love to see us get into the top 10.
Yeah, I mean, a surprising bit of a lot of, especially not lower seeds, sort of taking it multiple rounds in like we've seen in the past.
Yeah.
I thought it made for some great later round matchups. I like Michigan, one of the bigger upsetting teams, only as a 7 seed. But all of their games are exciting down the road. A lot of point by point and possession by possession type of games. Even West Virginia Gonzaga last night. Very exciting games late in the tournament, which is something we haven't got as much of, I think, in recent years. So that's been encouraging for me.
Actually very similar to the NBA in that the top teams seem just a little bit fallible, just shakeable, if you will.
Sure.
Too shakeable, because I will be drenched in cold water if they are too shakeable.
There you go. Speaking of just teams that maybe we didn't expect to win, Wisconsin and Florida, I don't think either team thinks they can lose right now, so I'm really watching that tonight. It won't necessarily be an upset, but I think if either of those teams makes the Final Four, it's kind of an upset of the whole bracket.
True.
If one of those teams makes it.
I think
it'll
be one of the best matchups. I can't wait to watch
I'm
game.
Calling
I like,
it
I
instant
like
classic. Yeah. We now move on. His name has been on the broadcast, Josh Jackson, but he's not the only elite NBA draft prospect this year. We're assuming he's going to be one and done. Don't see why not. Grace, I'll start with you. We got Lonzo. We got Markelle Fultz, who's not even in the tournament.
Right.
And the field, as we always have. who do you think that we should be really focusing on that can take their talents to the next level and thrive?
You know, as I said before, Jonathan Motley, looking for big presence in the NBA. I think a lot of bigs are starting to retire, actually. Like, we're looking at Tim Duncan has now retired. Dirk is going to move in and out. And there are only a few centers that you can really name. So it's going to be exciting to see him go to the NBA, see if he can muscle people around in the NBA as well. I think it's so funny that people are talking about Lonzo as a one seed. I just think that is the best discussion that has ever happened. Oh my God, LaVar Ball.
Yeah, no, and he's been so impressive, really, because you talk about all the sort of controversy that surrounds
exactly.
his dad
and
having a huge ego.
No,
he plays the absolute opposite. Yeah, no, he's a triple-double kind of player, passing to all of his teammates, doing the extra things on the floor, playing excellent defense. It really impresses me, if I was an NBA scout, his ability to, even as this controversy has come up, even through maybe the most hectic time of the year, he's able to not only maintain composure, but really take his game to the next level like he might in a perfect situation. Yeah. And to take a not great situation, especially from a noise standpoint, and be able to focus completely and take your team to next level, very impressive. I think we talk about intangibles and can guys concede at the next level in the next environment. That's been a great thing, I think, for him.
Another player I just want to throw out really quick is Lauri Markkanen.
Oh.
Loved watching him play in the Pac-12. I think a team maybe, I mean, I think he'd be a great prospect for the Spurs. Spurs would love to take him and build him into a fantastic style player.
How much time do we have left on this show? I could talk about that guy all day long. 7-footers who hit threes. Incredible. We're going to wrap this thing up, which is incredibly sad, but it's been an unbelievable experience. Final memos, I guess we could call them. We're going to just start out with saying thank you to everyone at Trojan Vision. Thank you
all
to John, the EP, all
the
camera people who made this happen.
Our station engineers, Rob and Carl.
That's it.
Absolutely.
Huge for Rob and Carl.
Number one boss.
It's been in the works for a while, and I think it's lived up to the hype, and I mean, you know, we hope it's back, but this has been incredible, and the work that people put in to make this happen. That is my memo finale for the day, but Lopez, I think, might have a bit more of a boisterous song to sing for his memo finale.
So this is a little thing we like to do at Southern California. It's called a SoCal spell out. So I'm going to need a little help from this. And everyone behind the camera, if you guys can hear them on the mic, so start to where you go, SOUTHANCALIFORNIA, Southern California. Beat the whoever we're playing next. We'll see you guys next time on the water cooler. I guess that's our outro. Yeah. I'm graduating in 2 months, so that was a highlight of maybe my entire
career. There are a lot of people walking around the quad right now. All of them were just looking at us, and that was a great
way to say
goodbye for the week. So the outdoor show, hopefully an absolute hit the first time around. Thank you so much for joining us every week. We're not outside every week, but we are at the desk, at some desk, at 2:30 every Friday. Have a wonderful weekend, and enjoy the madness.
Fight on.